Are we recording?
Are recording right now.
We are recording.
We are recording.
Look up at the clock.
See?
Okay. Hello. Put the camera on us, Carl. Six.
Oh, good evening. This is Union Buzz. And tonight, let me get us on. Tonight, we have special guests. This special guest is a regular special guest. We want you to call in because we want you to ask questions of Yolanda Williams, who is a police officer here in San Francisco. We want you to call in and ask questions. So the telephone number is 415-861-6648. We want you to call in because the topic is going to be very, very controversial that we're going to be talking about. So we want you to call in and ask questions about what's going on tonight. Okay, tonight, Yolanda Williams is here, police officer Yolanda Williams. And our hosts are Tami, Bryant, and Carl Bryant. Tami is a member of SEIU. She's a shop steward and a
delegate.
A delegate to the convention, and also she's working with SEIU on the Democratic, necessarily Democratic Party, but with politics and getting people elected here in San Francisco. That's all I'm going to say about that. If she wants to say something about it, that's good. I'd like to give a shout-out to all those letter carriers out there that are delivering mail at midnight in Oakland and Berkeley. That's ludicrous. That's the U.S. Postal Service not delegating work to other companies. They should be. Now, and also I'd like to give a shout-out to all those veterans out at Fort Miley and the Veterans Mental Health Committee. We need help out there. We got a lot of people with PTSD and other ailments and disabilities out at the VA hospital at Fort Miley. Okay, go ahead, Tami.
So, sorry for our rough start. We only have 8 minutes between shows, and we were still getting the camera set up. So that's live TV and public access. But we are live today. It is... It says 11-4, is that right?
Or
is
it 11?
Yes,
it is.
11-5. Is 11-4? I'm so out of it. Okay, it's 11-4, and we're live. Please call 415-861-6648. We are very excited to have the President of Officers for Justice with us, Yolanda Williams. And so we will hope you'll call in. There's a lot to talk about, and there's been a lot going on. I just do want to say that, yes, I am working on the political campaigns right now with San Francisco tenants and families, and it's a big push to get out the vote. If you want help filling out your ballot, hit us up on Facebook, and I will send you links for everything you need to know about how to vote. But, yeah, this is a really critical election, and unfortunately, the really good grassroots candidates are being outspent by third-party independent expenditures, like vastly, like $500,000 to $100,000. It's just incredible the way it's being outspent. And Carl doesn't know this yet, but the San Francisco tenants and families, employees, you know, folks from the community. And I was talking to somebody about a new job he has in his training, and he told me that he's working for the Postal Service. And I said, oh, what are you doing? And he said CCA, and I knew exactly what that was, City Carrier Auxiliary. And so I was going to let Carl know that I may be giving out his phone number to somebody, because we're going to see how it goes with the Postal Service. And it sounds like they're still trying to get folks with temporary positions who really should have permanent careers. So and I also do want to give a shout out to my grandson, Roman. I don't know why. I don't know what day it is. His birthday was on Wednesday, November 2nd. He turned 3 years old, and he went to Disneyland with his parents, the happiest place on earth. And I wish I could have been there with him, but I do want to give a shout out to him. So without any further ado, we want to welcome our guest tonight, Yolanda Williams. Thank you so much for coming on. We know you're busy and have a lot to do, a lot of responsibilities, and a very busy schedule. So we appreciate having you on. And there's just so much ground to cover. So thank you for coming.
Well, thank you for having me.
Yes. Again. And let me just say this. You can catch our last show on YouTube. I don't have the link. But if you go to Union Buzz, would it be on UnionBuzz.com?
It's on the Facebook page. I don't know about that. It's on the Facebook page.
It's on the Facebook page for Union Buzz. The link to the last week's show, so that you can catch up right away and then call in and ask questions of Yolanda. because she will answer every question you ask. And there's no doubt about it. She's always done that. She's been on the show a number of times, so don't be squeamish about calling. Any question is a valid question, especially in this matter with our Police Officers Association. I hate them. Anyway,
and,
go ahead.
And yes, we will be posting this show online too.
That's
and
POA, right? It's POA, right?
We want to have all the shows online so people can look at them. And we had a show, the last show we did it, we ran out of time, even though we went the full 52 right. minutes. So without any further ado,
all right, President.
We want to start with where you were, either you left off or what you think is a priority for tonight. And check the camera.
Yeah. Well, I think, first of all, we need to recognize that change is going to happen whether or not we embrace it. The future is always subject to change. And interestingly enough, we were going to be talking about what we can expect in the future of the San Francisco Police Department and That's really right. of policing in general. I got a message, which each day I get some type of message of encouragement from a group called Blue Courage. I took a training course with them today so that I can start to give instructions to other officers and people in the community so that they can have a better understanding of law enforcement and what we do and why we do some of the things that we do. And also to explain to others how people who are police officers, it takes a certain type of person, and it's a very noble position, and for in that sense it's so important that we continue to seek additional training so that we can maintain our professionalism. So I'm definitely committed to training and development of our police personnel. But this message that came in my inbox today was right to the point. And it says, change making happens when people fall in love with different versions of the future. Mm. And that's basically what is happening now in the 21st century. Change is occurring all over the place. We might make history in the United States on Tuesday, which I know you're excited about. We could have our first female president. So it's exciting times, but also at the same time, it's calling for a change in policing. The way we have traditionally done policing is no longer acceptable by the standards and the desires of the citizens and people that we serve. So we're looking, of course, for a new chief of police in San Francisco.
Right.
And there have been numerous rumors, there's been numerous articles, there's been conversations occurring all over the place as to who is and will be the next chief of San Francisco. It's a job that pays $315,000 a year. Jeez. It's the highest paid chief's position in the nation.
In San Francisco?
In San Francisco.
But in New York and Chicago, they have more people.
Oh, well.
Oh, San well.
Francisco this is San Francisco. Expensive.
Mm-hmm.
What about the administration? Those are the people our supervisor. Oh, wait a minute. Our supervisors and our mayor. Those are the administrators. And where are they at? What are they saying about this having the most expensive paid police chief in the nation, and the when the police department is running wild shooting people?
Well, it's not a concern. Well, I should say the concern from the supervisor's perspective, and we've been reading about it, and of course I've had an opportunity because as a president of the Officers for Justice, we frequently receive communications from supervisors, and generally they let us know what's the top priorities on their list. And of course, they are very interested and they want to become involved in this search, which was a national search for the next chief of police. The first thing that was of concern to them, as it has been mentioned by many of the citizens that have gone to police commission meetings over the last 4 to 5 months, is the requirements for the next chief of police. As you know, those requirements indicate that the next chief is only required to have a bachelor's degree, a BA, and there is no residency requirement.
I don't like that.
Well, yes, and there are the majority of the Board of Supervisors are really not happy with that, and it is my understanding that Supervisor Norman Yee has taken the lead to his credit, and he has listened to the citizens of San Francisco, and he too believes that the next chief must live in the city limits. And so he, and my understandings and readings and communications with his legislative aide, has drafted a resolution of some type to mandate that the mayor, when he appoints the next chief, make it very clear that that person must reside in the city and county of San Francisco. Mm-hmm. Because, you know, there's always terrorist threats. Right. Certainly nothing has happened here in our city. We've been extremely fortunate. However, you know, San Francisco is an iconic city. And we're a very diverse city.
Right.
And we need to make sure that we have the ability to respond to any type of critical incident in a very timely, efficient manner.
I was very shocked, actually, because I thought that, I know there's no residency law for rank and file or frontline staff, city employees and stuff. We knew there wasn't one for them, but I thought just like the mayor has to live in San Francisco or the supervisors have to live in a certain district to be eligible, I had always assumed that the police chief had to live in the city. And then it was at a police commission meeting that I learned that that's not, in fact, the case. And I wondered if they were doing that because of Tony Chaplin, because they want to appoint him and he doesn't live in the city and they're trying to acquiesce to him, or if there's, or I don't know. But it was a real big alarm to me. And I'm really happy to hear about Supervisor Norman Yee. And I think as citizens, we need to show our support and mobilize to make sure that it is made clear to whoever the new next chief is that they must live in the city. And I was going to say, I saw Susie Loftus on the news this week, and she was justifying how they're not going to release the names. They're keeping the finalists secret. And she said, well, you know, because most of them have other jobs, and, you know, we don't want to jeopardize that, or then people in the future won't apply. But I thought that's kind of funny, because other police chiefs that have left the Bay Area, like the one from Richmond who was great, Chris Magnus. Yeah. Mm-hmm. When he left, we heard he might go to, I think, Arizona. So right. How is it that we hear when our chiefs are looking for other jobs or being considered for other positions, and we hear this? So I found her argument kind of I found it baseless, to be honest, because we've seen where they do reveal this and announce this. So I don't know what your thoughts are on that.
Wait a minute. Let me ask this one question. How long have you lived in San Francisco?
60 years.
Thank you. That's all I have. That's all I need to know. I mean, here's a police officer who's been here most of her life, yet you're going to select someone who makes 3, 4, maybe 5 times her salary, and he doesn't have to even live here. So it could be like the Loma Prieta when the Bay Bridge crashed and the people had to put out fires and the people had to go around and fix utilities. And where was the police department? On the other side of the bridge. And they couldn't get here.
Public safety fire,
I think this is ludicrous that this city, small as it is, does not afford to have every city worker reside in this city that pays their salaries. That's my position. Always been my position since 1985, and I want to commend you for being here. And I want you to say something about that. I want you to say something about that.
Well, first of all, my entire life I've always thought that the chief of police and the fire chief and the mayor, the board of supervisors, and I know all the commissioners are required to live in the city mm-hmm. and county of San Francisco. So I, too, Tami, was alarmed when I heard that there was not going to be a residency requirement. Again, as times and people have been able to sophisticate their crimes at such a level, and they can do so much damage in just a matter of milliseconds.
Yep.
I would hate to see our city have to wait for its emergency service personnel and in the event of some type of major emergency. Unless we're going to get a helicopter again and, and make it available 24/7 in the event of some type of emergency.
No, don't give them ideas. Don't give them ideas.
Just find a police chief. The flat from Oakland to bring the police chief over here. From Berkeley Hills to find a police chief over here.
I mean, it's a thought.
No, don't give them no ideas. They'll try to weasel out of it then.
But, you know, again, Supervisor Norman Yee is listening to his constituents, as he should, and he's following up on the matter, and I'm certain that he will be taking that up with our mayor, and I feel confident that there will be many other board members that will echo his same sentiments, in as much as it's a major portion of the budget. It's a good portion of the budget for the department, and actually they have to approve the finances and everything as it is. So I can understand the concerns, and again, you know, it's if you want a position of this caliber, then sometimes you have to be willing to make certain sacrifices in order to achieve those positions. So we'll see what's going to happen with that. The jury's still out on it. But, you know, also it's my understanding that on November 5th at 5 p.m., there's going to be a joint meeting with the police commissioners and the Board of Supervisors at City Hall. And that meeting is supposed to specifically be for the purposes of discussing some of the findings in the DOJ and the COPS report that we had discussed last week.
Yeah.
And, of course, that's 272 findings. So I don't think they're going to get through all 200, the discussion of all 272 findings at this one meeting, unless they're planning on staying there for several days. But, again, that will be, I believe, open to the public at 5 p.m. on November the 15th. And I think it's very important for citizens who are concerned about the status of the next chief of this great city. I should say this iconic city.
Iconic city.
I think that you should be out there to voice your opinions as to what you truly seek and desire in your next chief.
I would like to say this too, that because of the city, because President Yolanda Williams is giving our audience information about this next meeting, we would like for you to show up, because you will be able to speak out about this, I think, at the end of the meeting.
I believe that they should have some time on the Sunshine Act for public comments.
Public comment.
Right. And this is a joint board.
This is necessary that we have public comment. Go ahead.
Sorry, it's a joint meeting between the Board of Supervisors and the Police Commission.
Absolutely.
5 p.m. on Tuesday, November 15th.
Correct.
Is the big administrator, the mayor, going to be there?
I have no idea. They have not indicated. But, however, it's interesting you bring up the mayor. Because today, and there's a news article that indicates that our mayor has is being considered for a possible vacancy should Hillary Clinton become the
new president
of the United States. So, needless to say, our mayor may also be leaving a vacancy in the city and county of San Francisco. So it's quite possible that he may attend the meeting on the 15th, or, hey, he may be in Washington, D.C. by then. You know, we just don't know.
Yeah. That's scary.
Well, I certainly hope he'll be very responsible and highly accountable to us and will not just make some kind of bad decision because he's like, he won't have to be around for the consequences or the aftermath. I hope he's going to take his duty to us very seriously.
I think considering that he would be considered for such a esteemed position, potentially with the next president and the first female president of the United States, she is actually, in considering him to be a cabinet member in some capacity, is showing that she's been watching the city and county of San Francisco. Being said, I would think that the mayor would use his ultimate good, responsible judgment and interview all seven of the candidates that were initially in the pool, the latest pool, and not just the three that were recommended to him by the commission, so that he can make certain that he has selected the most viable, qualified, educated, experienced, reformist in the nation.
Yes.
Because that's really what it's going to require to get through 272 Department of Justice findings and the 80 findings of the Blue Ribbon Panel for a total of 354 corrections that need to be made within the next 3 years. Wow. So that's about 110 and a half per year, which would have represented the mayor's last 3 years of his term of office. So I would recommend whoever they select for their next chief that they put them under contract. The contract needs to say every year you better get through at least 100 findings per year. And that's what you're going to be evaluated on. So that means that we pay you for 100 initiatives, $300,000 plus per year for you to achieve these goals, which are the goals of the mayor. He said, we're going to get through it.
Right.
And so
he did say we're going to get through
Yes,
it.
He did. He said we were going to do all of them.
That's right.
Otherwise, we know what the consequences are for failure, which is that the city and county will go under federal consent decree order, which will then we will be under scrutiny of the United States government, the presidential seal. And then we will be like our sister city across the bay, Oakland, trying to find our way out of a big cesspool.
That's right, yeah.
However, it took us about 180 years in total to get to where we are now. So I think that it's interesting that after 180 years, we're finally realizing that tradition doesn't work. It's time for change.
It's time for change.
Well, my question is the city of San Francisco and the POA and our administrators, including the mayor and the board of supervisors, ready for change? Are they ready for change? That's the most important issue I can come up with. Are they ready?
Well, you know, I have to say that I believe that the Board of Supervisors are ready for change because they want to hold people accountable. And I think they are finally starting to hold people accountable. And I think that's only because the citizens have demanded accountability. Okay? So I will give you all the credit first and foremost. And I want to believe that the police commission, too, has their hearts in the right area individually.
Let her finish.
Individually, they're very good, good people. And I appreciate the fact that they donate so much of their time to deal with the issues that the police department faces on a weekly basis. It's not easy.
It's not easy when you accept the money from the police department either.
Carl.
Well, now, I wouldn't say that. I'm not gonna tread down that one.
I'm gonna say that
my concerns are that perhaps the commission should have term limits like Board of Supervisors have.
Term limits, yeah. Mm-hmm.
Term limits. So maybe that's a way to start to hold them more accountable as well. Mm-hmm. And to also show transparency. Because now they're telling the police department and they're telling the officers that we're going to hold you accountable.
Right.
We believe in transparency. We believe in procedural justice. We believe in the legitimacy of policing and all those other wonderful buzzwords. So, but wait a minute. What about you too? So I think you need to take part in this as well.
Yeah.
So that's one way. Another thing we can do is, why don't we also consider, you know, the pledge, the not on my watch pledge that they made the officers take?
That's right.
Why haven't the police commissioners taken that pledge?
That's a very good point.
Wait a minute. That was started right here on this show.
Yes.
And President Yolanda Williams brought that, and it went nationwide. And now you're coming back saying that they're not doing it?
Well, they, no,
the police commissioner should
I think the police commissioner should also take the pledge to not on my watch, because it talks about instilling trust with those that you serve, who are the citizens.
That's right.
It talks about remaining unbiased. It talks about being ethical. Mm-hmm. And I think that they too should take the same pledge that they expect members of the police department to take. And in fact, I would say, why not have the Board of Supervisors take the pledge? Let's all take the pledge, okay?
That's right.
Wait a minute. I don't know too many politicians that are ethical.
Carl. Period.
Well, we want to keep them focused and reminded on the fact that ethics are important. Because if you want to hold your police department accountable to be ethical, then everyone has to also have clean hands and act in an ethical manner.
Right.
So I'm saying, we'll forgive the past, okay?
Mm-hmm.
Now take the pledge and let's clean the slate and let's all start off fresh and new. Let's start off with the new chief. Let's start off with a whole new vision for the police commission. Let's start off with whole new visions of city government. How about that?
I take the pledge.
Okay, good. See, that's a start. That's a start.
I take the pledge.
That's a start.
I take the pledge.
And we just need
not
you
on
to
my watch.
Watch what you say about politicians. We agree that there's ethics problems with some of the politicians, but not all of them.
We've got some good ones that are really trying to do the right thing. And the other concern that we should really have about this whole process of the chief police is, you know, there was a session when Commissioner DeJesus, to her credit, along with Commissioner Wang, attempted to put forth a resolution that would have stated that the finalist, or I should say the final three names that they were ready to submit to the mayor, would be made known to the public.
Exactly.
So the public would have an opportunity to see who these people are, get a little bit more background on them, etc. However, that resolution was voted down by the majority. And what's interesting is just 3 days ago, I received a ping on my phone at about 1:30 in the morning And one of my colleagues that's a member of Noble, and also a few of my members of the Officers for Justice, had sent me the same article. And I said, oh boy, this must be a doozy. What's going on here? As I read the article, it indicated that four of the seven candidates were outsiders. Mm. And it indicated what city and states they were potentially from. Whoa. And I said, well, now, how did we get this information? I said, I smell a leak somewhere. And then, of course, the OFJ phone started to ring. Mm-hmm. And there was some question about the fact that here we had the majority of the commissioners indicating that they were concerned about maintaining the confidentiality and the anonymous information of those candidates that were in the process because they didn't want to potentially jeopardize their jobs with their current agencies. We still don't know the specific names. However, when you put the city and the state, I mean, come on. Right. It's not that hard to try and figure out who's in command in various law enforcement agencies and then start to try and figure it out through deduction. But nonetheless, you then start to jeopardize maybe some people who really aren't even in the process. Mm-hmm. And then to add further insult to injury, they even tried to say that Director Ron Davis from the Department of Justice was one of the candidates, which he never has been, never will be. And I know that one factually because he has been a lifelong friend of the Officers for Justice, even before I ever became a police officer. Oh, wow. And he had indicated years ago, even if this position ever become available, for the chief of police in San Francisco, that he had no interest whatsoever. None. Hmm. So, folks, please believe me when I tell you that Director Ron Davis is not one of the people. That I can assure you, and he assured us of that even a few weeks ago when we had our meeting with him when we were discussing the findings under the DOJ. So it's unfortunate. It would have been nice if he would have been. However, he maintains his work ethics and the policies of Washington, D.C. when he took the contract.
And is he the former police chief from East Palo Alto? Or
yes,
I have it mixed
is.
Up.
Okay. Yes, he is. Okay. Yes, he is. Very highly credible man.
Right. I believe when he was there, when it was like the homicide capital of the world or something, and he was able to reduce the crime rate dramatically. Right. Yeah, so he is who I'm thinking of. Yes.
Yeah, he was instrumental in taking Palo Alto out of that murder capital of the United States.
Yeah, now it's really expensive to buy a home in Palo Alto.
Most people can't afford it.
Even in East Palo Alto. That's where he was, East Palo Alto.
He was in East Palo Alto. I know,
And the property value has just soared. Isn't that incredible?
That is very incredible.
Yeah.
So let's remind people that you can call in live, excuse me for interrupting, 415-861-6648. Again, 415-861-6648. We're here with Yolanda Williams, the president of Officers for Justice. This is also on our Facebook page. So if you do miss us tonight, please, you know, leave us questions there. We'll make sure they get answered on the next show.
Unionbuzz.com.
Or you can visit unionbuzz.com. For updates or but the feedback I think mostly would go to the Facebook page. But we hope to get some calls tonight. But if not,
and if you missed this program, it will be up on YouTube and we'll have the link on the Facebook page.
Yes. Okay. Yes.
And the other thing that I think is now something that citizens should consider in the wake of all of this information leaking out some kind of way, And it's interesting that everything's leaking out, but the names of these folks.
Right.
And so it's really interesting.
The town, where they work, the city.
Well, there's just the town and the state right now, but it's like, okay. But in as much as that has happened, I think we can kind of say this has not been as smooth as we would have wanted it to be. Mm-hmm. That being said, I think the way to make everyone feel a little bit more comfortable about the process in its entirety to assure our people that it has been above reproach, perhaps the mayor should consider telling the commissioners, I appreciate the three names, but I want to see all seven names, resumes, of those individuals that you had. And perhaps a forward-thinking mayor, an innovative mayor in such an iconic city as San Francisco would say, the money that we're paying and because of the state of affairs across this nation and the threat to Homeland Security, I want to personally interview each of those seven candidates. And when I interview them, I also want to have members of my board of supervisors also present, as they will be representing the citizens of this great city.
That's very profound.
I like that.
That is very profound.
Wow.
That, you heard that first here. Like a lot of things you're hearing here on this program are the first. And I think that is the most profound statement I have heard. And you know why I think it's so profound? Because I don't believe they're going to do it. I do not believe the mayor is going to do that.
Well, you know, this is now where it becomes the people's choice and the people's right. So at this point, this is when the people have to use their voices and their ability to pick up the phone, their ability to use emails, their abilities to be able to speak with the mayor when he's at various meetings and whatnot, and let him know what is your choice. Because after all, you're responsible to pay this next chief. You're not going to be the one that's going to be rating the next chief as to whether or not they are meeting the goals and objectives of the city. So the least you should be able to do is have your supervisors that are representing you, who you did elect,
that's right,
to be able to set in there and actually see what is going on and at least be able to assure you through no uncertain terms, that the most viable candidate was selected to be your next chief of police.
I mean, I think that's a great idea because that's, you know, we elect our board of supervisors to be our representative and be our voice. And, you know, it is a proxy, so to speak, because we can't all vote on everything. So we elect the people to vote for us or speak for us. And what better way to make the people have some input than to have a supervisor there, and it's not violating the boundaries of confidentiality or whatever.
No, it isn't. And then this way, if the mayor is leaving, at least he can sleep with himself at night saying that he allowed the people's voices to also be heard. Yes, ultimately he will make the final decision. However, I think it's incumbent upon this mayor that he allow some other people to also assist him in doing this job. He gave it to the police commissioners, and we didn't elect all of them. Some were his appointees, and we didn't actually have an election, a full election, where they were voted for and they won by majority. So for that reason, I think that's democracy that would be working at its best.
Yeah.
And I do believe that we do have a democratic mayor, and I do believe that he believes in democracy. And I do then believe that he wants to hear and do the will of the people. So,
Mayor Lee, I hope you heard this.
And we always say Democratic with a big D and a little D.
Yes.
Right. You know, he might be Democrat by party, but we want him Democratic in his philosophy and his way he performs.
And you have to be forward-thinking right now. Mm-hmm. And if you're talking about transparency and accountability, the mayor needs to show that he also embraces it. And this is the way for him to show that he embraces it. Because you should never, ever, ever give someone any position because of the color of their skin or because of the fact that it's tradition or anything else. It should be based upon your merit, mm-hmm. your expertise, your education, and your ability to be able to do the job in such an efficient manner that other cities across the United States would say, I want that person.
That's right.
I want that chief in my town.
Right. Right.
Are we paying them enough?
Well, you know what? If we're not the highest paid
police chief in the United States, we've got to be paying them enough.
But if we're not, then I say to the Board of Supervisors, consider maybe giving the person a little 2-bedroom cottage or something. Mm. In the city. You got enough properties that the city owns.
Ooh, yeah.
Give them a place to stay so that then there's no excuse why you can't stay on the premises that we've provided for you. Maybe it's a 2-bedroom condo or maybe it's a 2-bedroom home or whatever. Yeah. But I'm saying this is one way for you to also ensure your chief is where your chief needs to be.
Mm-hmm.
When you need them to be there when they're not in their office.
Right.
And, of course, if they're on vacation, we can't hold them accountable for that because they're entitled to vacation
and
days off and you get a break. But again, I mean, these are some things that I think we should be thinking about because ultimately, if we don't think about these out-of-the-box, innovative, we're going to wind up in the situation like Oakland, where we're going to be looking for chief after chief after chief. And that's embarrassing.
Oh, I know.
We still want to be San Francisco's finest. I know I do. I don't want to be involved in something that just gets a little bit too messy. And we need to show Oakland that we can practice reform and a mannerism far more professional than they ever dared to be able to do. Because you know they've been having problems even under federal oversight.
Oversight, right. Yeah. So. And the mayor, she's doing her best to try.
She really is.
She is trying to do her best.
She really is.
And, you know, we don't want to put Mayor Lee in the same boat.
No, we don't. And I want to give a shout out to Mayor Libby because I think that she's really trying her best to keep her department as professional as possible. And you know what the sad thing is, though?
I've heard
that they've had a problem trying to find a chief. And guess what? Some of the people supposedly that they've been trying to get to take a position with them have blatantly said absolutely not.
Oh.
Wow.
And they're now paying in excess of $300,000 for their next chief of police too.
They do. They pay that much?
They are now. They weren't before, but with all of this stuff, I understand
that people are
still declining.
Thank you, but no thank you, because they're so worried about the culture change. It's going to be so entrenched. It's going to be very hard to change.
Well, and then the other thing is that's why San Francisco has to show that we can do this search and conduct the search in a professional, uncompromised manner.
Right.
Because if there's any innuendos left that this was not a fair and impartial process, if there's any innuendos that this was more of a ritual and they already knew what they wanted to do, then that's going to unfortunately impact Oakland's ability to also get viable people. Because some of those people are going to say, look what happened in San Francisco. Why should we even think of Oakland? You know,
it's
so
right across the bay.
Yeah. Mm. So it's important, you know, that we realize that, you know, the failures though of the police department are not just the responsibility of the police department. Yes, it's the responsibility of the commissioners, whoever they were, all through the years and years, mm-hmm. 180 years. It's also been the responsibility of all the previous mayors and all the elected officials and leaders that were empowered during the reign of the San Francisco Police Department. Exactly. We all share a responsibility in where we are today. And if we all kept that in mind, we could all work together collectively and do the right thing, get the right person in here, and then make sure that there were succession plans for the future of San Francisco Police Department so that we never got ourselves into this type of situation again. How about the thought of having an assistant chief of police again? Do you think that might be
we used to have one.
They got rid of the position.
Well, Earl Sanders was the last assistant chief of police. And,
you know, that was a big scandal with Earl Sanders.
Yes, so
a big scandal.
So I think that perhaps you bring in a new chief, and then you tell that chief, whether they're inside or outside or whatever, you tell that chief, you're going to be looking through fresh lenses. I want you to also consider looking for an assistant chief for yourself, mm-hmm. so that you can be grooming someone.
Right.
Because it shouldn't be like one week you pick this particular deputy chief to fill in, and then next time it's a different one. No, you start grooming someone specifically for that job, so that if something happens to you, then we know that there's a succession plan that's already been put in place, so that if all of a sudden you have to be told goodbye, you're not all of a sudden saying, well, you know, I remember this guy down here, and I think that would be, no. We've got to do these things and handle these things very professionally.
Right.
And that's the way you do it. You start grooming people, and you have a specific developed standards. Mm. You develop the standards for what is needed in the next chief that might come behind you.
Mm-hmm.
And you look through your personnel and you find the most competent ones and you start developing them early on. And that's something that's missing also within the police department is a development program,
mm-hmm.
so that you're developing future leaders.
Right.
And you should develop future leaders even from the rank of police officers.
Of course.
You should be developing your future sergeants right then and there. And your lieutenants, etc. You should be identifying people whom you know have the qualifications and the capability to be good leaders and that are responsible people.
That's right. So. In a paramilitary organization, that always happens. Because you have your generals, you have your captains, a majors, captains,
mm-hmm.
and the infantry or the grunts are always being groomed to take the place of the person who might get killed in any kind of combat.
Exactly.
So, and this is the police department, whether we like it or not, mm-hmm. is a paramilitary organization. So they should be grooming police officers to take the places of sergeants, lieutenants, and captains. And captains should be being groomed to take the place of the police chief.
Exactly.
You know, but they're not doing that.
No.
They are not doing that.
We haven't done it in the past, and we need to start considering that as one of the most important things to do as well. And, you know, again, I have profound respect for each member of the police department, and I personally like all of them. But in order to fix these 345 identified deficiencies, it's imperative that we have a new set of fresh eyes to look at where we are today and take us to where we need to go
In the future, yes.
Yeah. So it's hard to believe, but we only have 2.5 minutes left.
Wow.
Yes, I mean, the time has just flown by.
But
so
wait a minute. She's
want to make sure, Yolanda, if there's any, yeah. I know, if there's any last thing that you have to get right. out to close out this discussion, well, we want to give you.
Well, again, the next chief of police has to be independent of the union.
Yes.
The police commission
of the police POA.
The POA, yeah, that's a police union, yeah, the POA. They have to be independent from the POA.
Okay.
The next chief of police has to make sure he's independent of them. The police commission has to be independent of the POA. And we have to move this use of force policy forward. The last police commission meeting, that came up again. And the thing that I hope to achieve through all of this is that, like the song that says, I want to rise up, our first lady was part of in helping those women, young women, see their future is that's bright right. for them.
Right.
I want to rise up for the members of OFJ. I want to leave them with a living legacy, a legacy that they can be proud of, and they can say that the OFJ ensured, and their last president made sure, that we were able to make strides in the higher ranks like we had never been allowed or able to do before. And that's going to require a chief that's a true reformist and a chief that has a new set of eyes to handle.
Well, thank you.
Wow.
That was very profound. I think that most of the conversation that Yolanda brought this evening were profound statements, in that she is, Yolanda has put a task on the administration on how to be more forthright and more transparent than they've ever been. And those things that you outlined, if they were to do that, they would be very transparent and very profound. I think it will set a new precedent. Go ahead, Tami.
So I just want to make sure, November 15th, 5 p.m., Board of Supervisors and the Police Commission, there's a joint meeting. We need to go there, and we need to take Yolanda's ideas and suggestions and make it come from us in the public. Thank you so much for coming on today.
This has been Union
Bus.
Okay. Unplugged. Thank you, Yolanda.
Okay.
All righty. Let me, bang.